relevant legislation. I just wanted to point out a few things. So the indictment is over 100 pages, but it's not because there are over 100 pages of allegations, though there are a lot of very specific allegations. What we have is a bunch of allegations repeated about five times throughout the indictment because they're being charged under a whole bunch of different pieces of legislation so that there won't be any sort of technicality defense, essentially, so that any specific legislation with any problem. So you might have heard about, for example, the honest services fraud law that's under constitutional challenge for being too vague. The prosecutor came back out and re-indicted so as to not have to rely on that sort of law. And if the allegations are true, then certainly we don't need a law like that because honest services is far enough. We're so far beyond that if the allegations are true because the charges are essentially a bribery, extortion, racketeering, and then a cover-up of lying to federation. So the allegations are, in terms of the bribes, in terms of what was offered, there's appointments to boards and commissions, awards of state funds, which is, of course, if it is true, then given the budgetary state of Illinois, it's particularly unfortunate, enactment of executive orders, and, of course, the appointment of the United States Senate position. And then in return, the allegation is that there was what was sought was straight-up monetary gain, campaign contributions, and then employment for friends and families, such as the governor's wife and brother. So we've really got a situation here where there's, on the facts that they're alleged in the indictment, a direct quid pro quo. So not just a denial of honest services, something a little bit more amorphous, but actually, you give me money, and I'll give you an appointment. And now, there's been a lot of focus on the Senate seat, obviously, because it's a Senate seat, and particularly it's President Obama's previous position. But it's actually that would actually be the hardest part of the allegation to establish because it was stopped prior to the alleged sale actually going ahead. But in contrast, if the facts as Fitzgerald presented them are true, I think that things like extorting a children's hospital for $50,000 in order to release $8 million from the fund is actually a lot more shocking and is actually something that's going to be easier to prove. Okay, so how would we go about proving it? We've all read about the excerpts from the tapes, some of those statements. It's a blinking, valuable thing. We're not going to give it away for nothing. If I don't get something of value, I'm going to take it for myself. I've got this thing and it's bleeding gold and I'm not just giving it up for nothing. So, any lawyer... Now, I'm just saying, I don't care about the language used. I'm used to it, but... that's right. but any lawyer worth their salt should be able to come up with an innocent explanation for this. And I think the governor previously has said, well, I could have been referring to helping people to get me to pass public works programs and jobs programs and so on. And what I'd say about that is jurors can, well, they can apply their common sense and say, yes, there's a possible innocent explanation for what we think is likely, given other evidence from co-conspirators, and presumably we'll have evidence from the targets, though the government's always maintained that the people who are actually targeted, according to the allegation, will actually help exonerate him. But then other things like, okay, so the governor knew that he was being taken at this point, he explicitly acknowledged it in 2008, and yet this is what he's saying on the phone, what might he actually have been saying off the phone? And is there just so much corruption endemic in Illinois that these things are something that that he thought was okay to say on the telephone that was being charged? So jurors can sort of apply that kind of common sense. All right, so in terms of my questions I want to get to, what I want to do is ascertain where exactly we can draw the line between what is legitimate for a governor or someone in another official position to ask for in return for something, say, like an appointment, and what's illegitimate. So vote trading, for example. I mean, we saw in the recent healthcare debate Ben Nelson saying, you know, I want Paul for my state, or I'm not going to sign on to healthcare. You might think that that's legitimate, particularly given your comments on, depending on whether you're doing policy good. But can we draw a clear line, and how do we draw the line between that and something like actual money for a campaign, an and then maybe another line between that and money in a brown paper bag.
Right, right. That's good. Now let me, I can answer this now. Let me, with all respect, Professor, there's a couple of mistakes you made. Not once anywhere in these allegations have they said that there was an express quid pro quo. Not once. And the law is very clear on fundraising. The McCormick case says, you can't say, give me $50,000, and in exchange for that, I'll do X public work. They're not even alleging an express quid pro quo, so that's not accurate. The other thing...
Okay, can I ask you about a specific allegation then that's made? Because I think that they do explicitly say quid pro quo.
Now when it comes to fundraising.
Some of it's indirect through now, AIDS or through Tony Rezko, but there are specific allegations saying that, that for example, there were multiple cash payments made to your wife in return for...
That is not true, and that is not an allegation. My wife worked for Tony Rezko, and I'm not supposed to talk about the case, but let me point this out. Everything we earned was disclosed. And these allegations, again, let me say something, okay? These same people that are saying these things, one of our earliest court appearances, they acknowledged I was indigent. In open court, the prosecutor told the judge he's indigent. Now, if I'm on some crime spree, and if you're to believe some of these phony allegations that are being made, you really think I'm so stupid that I don't have any money? I mean, I went to Northwestern. If they're saying that about me, what do they say about you? The fact is, these are preposterous allegations.
$25,000 in cash plus $25,000 in campaign money from Ali Atta for an appointment in the administration is one of the allegations. Refinancing billions of dollars in the Illinois pension funds that Tony Rezko is supposed to have arranged at your request. So lots of things that are explicit quid pro quos, and there are actual financial numbers on them. Some of them are cash, and some of them are for your campaign. So I don't know whether the allegations are true, but certainly what's in the indictment is quid pro quo.
They're not alleging quid pro quo, express quid pro quo when it comes to fundraising, and that's a requirement in the law. But beyond that, let me simply say again, the best evidence when you have people saying things is, what did they really say? And there are hundreds of hours of secretly taped conversations. My telephones were taped, my home phones for 6 weeks, my cell phones, my campaign office phones, the phones of advisors and staff and others were taped. Now, I have said, play all the tapes. I've instructed my lawyers to go into court, petition the court, and have an agreement with the government that we agree to play all the tapes so the full story is heard. The irony here is, just so you know who's lying, the accusers who took some of those conversations off the tapes, took snippets of them, have gone to court and have a court order preventing those tapes from being heard by the public or being heard or allowing me to tell you exactly what's on those tapes.
So
I can tell you effing golden, they don't tell you what the next sentence is and the context of that conversation. They misled the public, and I want to read from you a case. 1934 United States Supreme Court governing the ethics. This is the case that governs what prosecutors are supposed to do. I'm a former prosecutor. Berger versus United States, the government's role in a criminal prosecution, not that it shall win the case, but that justice shall be done. Individual prosecutor's role is the servant of the law with a twofold aim. Guilt shall not escape, nor innocence suffer. The prosecutor may strike hard blows, but he's not at liberty to strike foul ones. When the prosecutor gets up and lies to the case yet.
I mean, I don't think...
But you're buying into it, and you're taking
You deny whether there's an allegation of quid pro quo in the indictment.
In the fundraising.
I have no idea if it's true or not. I'm not privy to the private information that you are. But I can tell you what I've read in the indictment, and the indictment makes a claim of quid pro quo. I have no idea if it's true or not, but that's clearly what's in
the indictment. The indictment does not say express quid pro quo with any related fundraising. And let me point out,
I can give some more examples from the indictment, but I want to prefer that you answer the original question, what is the official to ask for? Is it okay to ask for votes to go a particular way and I'm given an appointment in return? Can we draw a distinction between that and asking for money for yourself? Is one okay and the other's not?